Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. Presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. You guide me in paths of righteousness for your name's sake.
Psalm 23 is probably the most read of the Psalms. In fact, it's one of the most well-known chapters in the Old Testament. And where is it read most of the time? At funerals, right? Funerals. And not just real funerals, but almost every movie and television show that has a funeral in progress, you hear the 23rd Psalm being read. And although this Psalm is great for funerals, Psalm 23 is not so much about dying as it is about living. And since most of you are awake this morning, you had an extra hour, you look pretty lively, we're gonna focus on that living aspect of it this morning. So Psalm 23, verse 1, it's a psalm of David, and it's a psalm to live by. Oh, it says, Psalm 23, verse 1, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. The Lord is my shepherd." Yahweh is my shepherd. The Lord is in all caps here. It means it's the word for Yahweh. It's the name of the Lord. Yahweh is my shepherd. Whose shepherd is he? He's mine, right? He's yours. He's our shepherd if we'll allow him to be. If we'll allow him to be. You know, the shepherd is the one that does the leading. He does the guiding. The shepherd is in charge. The shepherd calls the shots. The shepherd is the one we obey. So are you allowing God to be the shepherd in your life? Or are you the shepherd? Or is food your shepherd? Or is lust your shepherd? Or is envy your shepherd? Or is anger your shepherd? Or what about greed? Is that your shepherd? You know, when you have a minute alone and you think, no one is watching, what do you run to? When you're all alone, what do you run to? Do you run to the refrigerator for some comfort food? Do you run to the internet to lust after a pound of flesh? Do you run to the window and long for the life of your neighbor? Do you run to the nearest thing to throw because anger seems to just be inside of you? Do you run to your stock portfolio, your bank accounts, to feel secure about your net worth? When you're all alone, what do you run to? What guides you? What leads you? What drives you? When you're all alone, who is your shepherd? Well, whoever it is, or whatever it is, if it's not the Lord Jesus Christ, then it stinks, right? It's a lousy shepherd, isn't it? We've all been there. It's miserable. It's awful. It's a dreadful shepherd, yet we keep running to it, don't we? We keep seeking the comfort that it promises, yet it never fulfills. It never satisfies. It always leaves you empty. It always leaves you alone. It always leaves you wanting. When the Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. He won't leave us empty. He won't leave us alone. He won't leave us wanting. When the Lord is our leader, He will provide for us. And not just provide, but provide everything we need. When the Lord is our shepherd, when the Lord is our provider, we will not be left wanting. We will not be left in need. When the Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. When the Lord is our shepherd, He makes us lie down in green pastures. When the Lord is our caretaker, we can relax. When the Lord is our caretaker, we can breathe easy. When the Lord is our caretaker, we can sleep at night. When the Lord is our shepherd, He makes us lie down in green pastures. When the Lord is our shepherd, He leads us beside quiet waters. When the Lord is our peacekeeper, He's able to resolve conflict in our lives. When the Lord is our peacekeeper, He brings tranquility to our lives. When the Lord is our peacekeeper, He carries us in the calm, even in the midst of the storm. When the Lord is our shepherd, He leads us beside quiet waters. When the Lord is our shepherd, He restores our soul. When the Lord is our rejuvenator, we're brought back to life. When the Lord is our rejuvenator, we're overhauled, we're made new. When the Lord is our rejuvenator, we're revived and invigorated and revitalized. When the Lord is our shepherd, He restores our soul. When the Lord is our shepherd, He guides us in paths of righteousness. When the Lord is our director, He points us in the way we should go. When the Lord is our director, He shows us the trail that we belong on. When the Lord is our director, He steers us on the course of our life's purpose. When the Lord is our shepherd, He guides us in paths of righteousness. Well, why is the Lord our shepherd? Why does the Lord do all of this? We're told, for His name's sake. Why is He our shepherd? Why is He our leader? Why is He our provider, our caretaker, our peacekeeper, our rejuvenator, our director? Why is He all of these things to us? Why? For His name's sake, for His glory. He leads and directs us down the right path to bring glory to His name. Now, the righteous path, it's not always the easy path, right? It's not always the comfortable path or even the fun path. But it's the glorious path. It's always the glorious path. And sometimes it's the most difficult, the most overwhelming, the most seemingly impossible path that brings the most glory to God's name. You see, the world seeks to glorify its own name. Everyone in the world is seeking glory for their own name. Satan was cast out of heaven because he said that he would be like God. Satan was and is seeking to glorify his own name. But the big problem is, in all of this, Satan and all the fallen angels, and even God's holy angelic beings and all of us human beings, we are all created. We are created beings. We have a creator. You know, you don't sit down to a table with a nice plate of lasagna. Lasagna is one of my favorites. You know, you can see the steam coming off with all the cheese, the meat sauce, and you got the garlic bread and the nice salad on the side. And you don't sit down and start praising the meal, right? Oh, lasagna, you know, how did you make yourself so delicious? And you too, garlic bread, you know, your enchanting aroma lured me to the table. I mean, that would be idiotic. You don't praise the meal, you glorify the one created it. You know, you tell your wife or your mom or Stouffer's, hey, what a fantastic job they did creating this meal. And, you know, we are all created beings. God made us. And so he gets the glory. He's the creator. When we are saved, God is glorified. He is always glorified by those that have accepted his free gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. He is always glorified by his children, no matter what we do. Once we are his, he is always glorified by us. In Romans chapter 5, and you can turn there if you want, and it should be on here. We're going to cover a lot of scripture today. So keep your finger in Psalms 23. We'll be going back. But in Romans chapter 5, starting in verse 18, Paul writes to us, and he says, so then, as through one transgression, and this is through Adam's sin, through one transgression there resulted condemnation to all men, even so through one act of righteousness, Jesus Christ on the cross, there resulted justification or life to all men. For as through the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, even so through the obedience of the one many will be made righteous. The law came in so that the transgression would increase. But where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. So that as sin reigned in death, even so grace would reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And in chapter 6, verse 1, he continues, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin so that grace may increase? May it never be. How shall we who died to sin still live in it? You see, the more sin there is, the bigger God's grace is shown to be. And God's name is glorified by his grace. You know, the angelic beings and maybe the people that are in heaven already, they see God's love and they see his mercy and his forgiveness. And they see God's grace poured out to cover such a magnitude of sin. And their jaws drop to the floor. I mean, how could God's grace be that big? How could God's love cover all of that sin? You know, that guy lived the most wretched life ever. And yet God still made salvation available to him. I mean, it's amazing. It's glorious, right? Praise God. But for the unbeliever, for the lost person, they're not so impressed. You know, they see the lives of a wretched life like this. And because the guy said a little prayer or he goes to church or whatever, you know, they don't know. They say, man, and he gets to go to heaven because of that? If that's what heaven is, man, I don't want to be there with that guy. I don't want to be up there with Ted Bundy or whoever, right? And so the lost don't understand grace until they experience it for themselves. They don't see it. God is glorified by the pouring out of his grace. But the lost people, they don't see it. Not yet. They will, but they don't now. And what I'm getting at is this. As believers, God is glorified no matter what we do. If we continue to sin, God's grace will abound. Paul says in the strongest words possible, don't do that. But God's grace will abound. It will prevail. It's bigger than any amount of sin. And so you could possibly be the greatest exhibition of God's grace that ever walked this earth. And that kind of sounds great, I guess, right? But it's kind of like being, though, the biggest ball of tin foil, or aluminum foil, they call it nowadays, right? And people come by and they look at it and they say to the owner, you know, that's a big ball of foil. Wow. You know, incredible. What does it do? You know, what do you do with it? What's the purpose does it serve? And Guy says, well, you know, it really doesn't do anything. I mean, it doesn't have a purpose. It just sits here. You can't do anything with it. It's just to say, you know, I made the biggest ball of foil. It's huge, right? And in fact, it took thousands and thousands of rolls of foil to make it. Yet one single roll of foil still on the roll is probably 1,000 times more useful. I mean, you can use it than this big giant ball of foil. Turn with me to Timothy chapter 2, verse 20. 2 Timothy, I'm sorry. And it'll be up here too. And Paul writes here, he says, now, in a large house, there are not only gold and silver vessels, but also vessels of wood and earthenware, some for honor and some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from these things, he will be a vessel for honor. Sanctified. Sanctified means set apart. Useful to the master. Prepared for every good work. Now flee from youthful lusts and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart. So every house has vessels, containers, some for honor, useful to the master, some for dishonor, not so useful, although they do have a purpose. And what is our purpose for still being here on this earth? You know, if our only purpose was to get saved, to accept God's free gift of salvation, why are we still here, right? Why didn't God just take us up to heaven when we got saved? We completed the task, game over, let's go home. We're done, right? But Jesus did give us a purpose, didn't he, beyond our salvation. And he says in Matthew chapter 28, we call it the Great Commission. Most of you have heard this many, many, many times. And Jesus writes in Matthew chapter 28, starting in verse 19, he says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. He's speaking to his disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. So it's passing it on. You're my disciples now. You train these disciples. You tell them to do what I'm telling you to do. And lo, I am with you always, even till the end of the age. And so we have a purpose. And that purpose is to deliver the gospel. That purpose is to make the good news of Jesus Christ on the cross known to the world. To make it known to the lost. And so we're still here on this earth, right? We have a purpose to make the good news known. To deliver the goods. And, you know, God, he surveys the workplace. He surveys the neighborhood. He surveys the kids' sporting events, the soccer and Little League and whatnot. He surveys the market. He surveys the Walmart, everywhere, right? God looks over everywhere. He sees it. And he sees who is thirsty. He sees who is lost. He sees who is longing to hear the living word of God. And he sees who is ready for a drink of the water of life. Because God is always ready to pour it out, right? And so he has those that are ready for a drink of the living water. He has the living water, right? It's his word. It's the Holy Spirit. It's the good news of Jesus Christ on the cross. God has the living water in ever abundant supply, overflowing. And he has the people ready for a drink. They're thirsty. They're parched. They're literally dying for a drink of this living water. And so all God needs is a container to deliver it in. That's what our purpose is. And Jesus says, behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes, look on the fields. They're white for harvest. You know, they're ready. There's thirsty people out there. It's ready for the harvest. He just needs containers, the harvesters, right? He just needs vessels, containers. You know, my house, my personal house, has lots of containers. Some of them we cook in, some of them we eat out of, some of them we drink from. Containers of honor, right? Many, many containers in my house. But there's two containers that are specifically used for dishonor. They have a purpose, but it's kind of dishonorable. We call them the toilets. And when we're not allowing God to be the shepherd in our lives, you know, when food is our shepherd, or when alcohol or drugs is our shepherd, or when lust is our shepherd, or when envy is our shepherd, or when anger is our shepherd, or even greed, when we pursue these things and we follow after them, we make ourselves vessels of dishonor. You know, God cleanses us, we're told. And he makes us vessels of honor. He sets us apart. And then we fill ourselves again with the refuse of sin, and we make ourselves vessels of dishonor. We make ourselves toilets in a way. And sure, God's grace will abound. It will. It'll cover that. The angels will be amazed, you know, that God let another toilet into heaven, right? Another giant ball of tinfoil. It's just amazing to witness God's grace, an incredible showing of God's grace. But at the same time, there's not a lot of use in it for God here on this earth. It's not a valid tool. He can't use it. And, you know, the fact is, no matter how thirsty a lost person is, no matter how parched they might be, no matter how desperate and ready to be harvested, no matter how much they long for the living water of life, they're not going to drink it from a toilet. I mean, they just won't, right? They won't drink it from a toilet. I mean, would you? You know, we're at the workplace or we're at the market or wherever we are, and we say, "Hey, let me tell you about Jesus. He's my provider." You know, and the person says, "Well, he is? Why are you always sweating over the stock market? You know, why are you always worried about money? Hey, let me tell you about Jesus. He's my peacekeeper. Man, he gives me peace beyond understanding." He does? I certainly don't understand it. The way you're always blowing your top and having temper tantrums here, it doesn't seem very peaceful to me. Hey, let me tell you about Jesus. He's my supplier. He supplies exactly what I need. He does? Why are you always talking about your brother-in-law, you know, with the new Corvette and the big house and the ski boat and all that? Hey, let me tell you about Jesus. He's my coach. You know, he's my trainer. He is? You know, does your coach tell you to eat all that garbage all the time? You know, it looks like the refrigerator or something's your coach. Hey, let me tell you about Jesus. He's my champion. He's my heart's desire. He is all that I need. He is? You know, why are you always looking at women like that? Drooling over them, or why are you always reading those trashy romance novels? You know, lusting in your mind or lusting in your eyes. You know, God cleanses us. He makes us vessels of honor, and then we will fill ourselves with the refuse of sin, and we make ourselves vessels of dishonor. And no matter how thirsty a lost person is, no matter how parched they might be, no matter how desperate and ready to be harvested, no matter how much they long for the living water of life, they're not going to drink it from a toilet. I mean, they just won't. They're not going to drink it from a toilet. You know, so you want to quit smoking, huh? Well, hey, let me tell you what worked for me. Right. Right? Hey, are you going to listen to that, you know, or the guy, Hey, so you want to stop drinking, huh? Well, bartender, bring another round over here. Well, let me tell you what's worked for me to quit drinking. You're not going to listen to that, right? Because there's no evidence there. You're just not going to listen. So in Psalm, back to Psalm 23, verse 4, he writes, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me." You know, I think at a funeral, they usually infer that this valley is like the crossing over from this world, the physical, to the eternal world, to the spiritual. But I don't see that as the intent of David here. I think he's calling the life here on earth, in this sin-tainted world, is walking through a valley that is overshadowed by sin and by death. You know, before Adam sinned, there was no death. But since then, we live in a world that is tainted by sin, a world that is always overshadowed by death, right? Death is always looming. It's always pending. It's always approaching. It's always there just waiting. Turn with me to John chapter 17. Jesus, in his high priestly prayer, Jesus is praying to God the Father on behalf of his disciples, his followers, the sheep that he is the shepherd of. And he says here in John 17, verse 15, as he prays to God the Father, I do not ask you to take them out of the world, but to keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them, purify them, set them apart in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. For their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they themselves also may be sanctified in truth. Not of the world. We are not of this world, of this valley that is overshadowed by sin and death, a valley where the evil one and the rest of the countless fallen angels roam, seeking whom they're going to devour. Jesus says he wants us here. He doesn't want us to be taken out of this world, because he wants to use us here. He has a purpose. Set us apart. Sanctify us. He has a purpose for our lives. He has a purpose for your life here on this earth. And that purpose has eternal implications. Right here in the valley overshadowed by sin and by death. You know, Jesus says we're not of this world. If you've accepted God's free gift of salvation, your citizenship has been moved. You are no longer an earthling. You're a citizen of the kingdom of God. And Jesus says, sanctify them to the Father. He says, sanctify them, purify them, cleanse them, make them vessels of honor, and then send them into the world. Purify them and send them into the valley that is overshadowed by sin and by death. And how are we to be cleansed? How are we to be purified? How are we to be sanctified? How are we to be made vessels of honor? Jesus says, by the truth. And knowing that we would say, well, hey, what's the truth? What's that mean? You know, isn't truth relative, right? Knowing this, he goes ahead and defines it. Truth for us right there. He says to God the Father, your word is truth. So that's what it is right there. John, if you turn forward to John chapter 1, he expands a little more on what his word is also. It says in John chapter 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, right? And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. And then down in 14, John chapter 1:14, he says, then the Word became flesh, Jesus Christ, and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, the glory as the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. You know, God's a spiritual being, God the Father. He's not made up of physical material. He's not made from molecules. He's not made from atomic structure. If you put your hand under the microscope, if you had one this good, I guess, and you zoomed all the way in, you're going to see the individual cells, and then you're going to see the inner workings of the cells, and then the molecules and the atoms, right? The atomic structure that make up the tiny molecules, that make up the parts of the cell, that make up your hand. If you put God's hand under the microscope, you're not going to see atoms. He's not made of physical material. And so to make himself known to us, he took himself and his essence and his thoughts and his desires, and he transcended them into this physical world through the physical being of Jesus Christ, or maybe the physical part of Jesus Christ, because he's a God also. And then God also put himself into words. The expression of himself, his thoughts, his desires, into written form, into a written book. We call it the Bible. And yet another way God has transcended himself into this world, into this valley overshadowed by sin and death, is through the Holy Spirit, who resides in our lives, inside of each one of us, when we become believers. And so the truth of God's word that sanctifies us and purifies us and makes us vessels of honor, it's expressed to us in three ways. It's expressed through the example of Jesus Christ walking through this same valley, overshadowed by sin and death, but he did it in complete victory, didn't he? Because he kept his eyes completely on the Father at all times. He always followed the Father's will, always followed the Father's lead, his direction, his shepherding. He followed him. He completely relied on God as the shepherd in his life to lead him through the valley all the way to the cross, right? Well, secondly, the truth of God's word that sanctifies us and purifies us and makes us vessels of honor is in the written word of God, the Bible. The essence of God in written form right here. We all have a copy. You remember Jesus always referred to God's or deferred to God's written word of God. He always was quoting the word of God. Thirdly, the truth of God's word that sanctifies us and purifies us and makes us vessels of honor is the Holy Spirit that dwells inside of us. It's the essence of God living in our hearts, leading and guiding, prodding us, warning us, equipping us with special gifts that we can build up the whole body of Christ with, that we can build up the church with, that we can build each other up with. That's the whole point of those. Back to Psalm 23, verse 4 says, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." Even though we've been sent into this world that is overshadowed by sin and by death, we don't need to fear evil. We don't need to fear sin and fear death. We don't even need to fear Satan and the fallen angels. Why? Because God is with us, and His leading and guiding, His training, His coaching provides comfort for us. Well, how do we know this? How do we know that He is with us? He tells us here, but does He mention it again? Well, He does. In Hebrews chapter 13, verses 5 and 6, He says, "Make sure that your character is free from the love of money, being content with what you have, for He Himself has said," and this is God, a quote from the Old Testament, "God the Father Himself has said, 'I will never desert you, nor will I ever forsake you,' so that we confidently say, 'The Lord, Yahweh, God the Father, is my helper. I will not be afraid. What will man do to me?'" So God the Father has said, "I will not desert or forsake you," so that we can say we won't be afraid. Then in Matthew chapter 28 again, verses 19 and 20, the Great Commission, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So Jesus says He is with us always. God the Son, He is with us always, even to the end of the age. Then in John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17, Jesus says, "I will ask the Father, and He will give you another helper, that He may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it does not see Him or know Him. But you know Him because He abides with you and will be in you." The Spirit will be with us. God the Spirit will be with us forever. He will be with us and in us, and He will come upon us, empowering us. So we don't need to fear evil because God is with us. God is with us, Father, Son, and Spirit. We are never in situations that God isn't aware of because God never leaves us. God never forsakes His people. He is always here right by our side. Praise God for that. Verse 5 of Psalm 23 says, "You, God, You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." God, our provider, our supplier, our sponsor, our benefactor, even with enemies all around, our gracious shepherd provides shelter and safety. And not just shelter and safety, but a table, a place to relax, a place to eat off of, a place to rest and to be refreshed. As we tread, as we hike, as we march through this life, as we stride through this valley that is overshadowed by sin and by death. You know, it was the custom of a loving host to provide oil for the hair of their guest. It was to refresh him after his travels. Today, this would be like your host providing a nice hot shower, right? That after you're out hiking all day, and it's just relaxing, refreshing, invigorating, renewing. You know, God is our gracious host. He provides shelter and protection for us. And we can rest in His presence. We can relax in Him. He will refresh us. He will invigorate us. He will renew us. David says, "My cup overflows." In John chapter 4, verses 13 and 14, it says, "Jesus answered and said to her, 'Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life.'" And then in 2 Corinthians 4:7, it says, "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, so that the surpassing greatness of the power will be of God and not of ourselves." Our lives are the earthen vessels. And God loves to fill us until we overflow. Our bodies are these earthen vessels. And the water that He gives us will become a well of water just springing up inside of us, unending. Guys, this is what ministry is all about. We don't need to learn tactics and strategies and programs. No, this is the way to live and minister, just being filled and being anointed by God with this well of life-giving water springing up inside of us, overflowing into the lives of others around us. This is the way to live and minister. This is the way that God has chosen to make Himself known to the world. He has chosen to use us, earthen vessels, that He overflows until it spills into the lives of those around us. And God is so good. He is the good shepherd, and He is the only good shepherd. Do you remember when Moses misrepresented God and he struck the rock in anger at the people? He was angry with the people. God wasn't. God wasn't angry at all, but Moses was. And because Moses misrepresented God, because Moses pulled the refuse of sin into his vessel of honor, and he was an honorable vessel, because Moses turned his vessel into a toilet, God said, "I will not allow you to bring my people into the promised land." You know, Moses was one of the most awesome servants of God ever. And no doubt, he's in heaven glorifying God at this very moment. God's grace covered him. It was just a mistake. But his service, it came to a point where he limited how God could use him here in the valley because of that, because of the sin. Again, who is your shepherd? You know, whose lead are you following? Are you following God to be the shepherd in your life? Are you allowing Him to be the shepherd in your life? Or are you the shepherd? Or is food your shepherd? Or is lust your shepherd? Or is envy your shepherd? Or is anger your shepherd? Or is greed your shepherd? When you have a minute alone and you think no one's watching, what do you run to? When you're all alone, what do you run to? You know, Moses ran to anger and it made his vessel dishonorable, not fit to bring the people into the promised land. What a tragedy, right? Such an awesome vessel that God used in such magnificent ways. And because he ran after another shepherd, just for a moment, he limited how God could use him. But you know, it's not too late for us. God will use us. He wants to use us. He desires to use us. And he will clean us up again, like he always does, right? He always does. And he will use our vessels the best way that he can. But he can't use our vessels if we keep making ourselves a toilet. Verse 6 says, "Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life." You know, David, knowing that God is his perfect shepherd, knowing that God is his leader, his provider, his caretaker, his peacekeeper, his rejuvenator, his protector, his trainer, his supplier, his benefactor, his sponsor, his director, his guardian, his coach, his defender. Knowing that God is his champion, David says, "Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life." How could it not, right? And that goes for us too. When we allow God to be our shepherd, surely goodness and loving kindness will follow us. It will pursue us all the days of our lives. All the days of our lives. All the days of our lives. How many days are left? I mean, how long do we have? We know the Lord's coming is soon. It's on the horizon. But we also know that our going to Him will be soon. It's on the horizon. Death is always looming. It's always there. Many of us have lived half of our lives. Many of us three quarters. Many of us have lived a full life. How long? How many days left? And how long will we pursue other things as our shepherd with those days? You know, those things aren't going to go away. They will always be in the valley. They will always overshadow the valley. I mean, that's what the valley is. Jesus walked through this same valley, overshadowed by sin and by death, completely and totally following the leading and guiding of the Good Shepherd, of the Father. That's our example. In Romans, Paul encourages us here in Romans chapter 8, I can find it. Romans chapter 8, verses 37 through 39. He says, "But in all of these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through Him." And that's the key word there, guys. Through Him. We don't conquer them on our own. In all of these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor debt, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Guys, there is not much time left. If you have trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, God has saved you by His grace alone. His glorious grace, He is glorified by that. And He has left you here in the valley for a purpose. He has a reason for you being here. He has plans to use you. A vessel that He has cleansed and sanctified or set apart for a specific purpose and will continue to cleanse. Don't foil His plans. Like Moses, don't thwart the plans of God in your life by continuing to run after sin. We need to stop making ourselves toilets. And the only way to do that is to completely trust and rely on God, our shepherd, for everything. I mean, for everything. Like Jesus did. Every day, every hour, every minute, every second. We can't take our eyes off of Him for even a second. Because we're surrounded in this valley by all these other things. And we'll immediately go to the other things. We can't take our eyes off of Him for a second. And why would we want to, right? You already know that in everything else, it never fulfills, right? It never satisfies. It always leaves you empty. It always leaves you alone. It always leaves you wanting. But when the Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. All the days of my life, all the days of our lives, how many days are left? Guys, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for being our shepherd. We thank You for loving us and for doing such a magnificent work in our lives, Lord, in this showing of Your grace. And You've forgiven us time and time again. You forgave us once and for all for everything, Lord. But we bring these sins to You. We make ourselves dishonorable when we pursue these other things, Lord. And You have forgiven us. And You clean us up again. And You make us all vessels of honor. And Lord, I just ask that You would just purify us this morning. That right now, we would just bring those things to You in our minds. Lord, these things of dishonor, these things that have dirtied us, Lord, these things that limit how you can use us, these things that make us unuseful as a tool in your hands, Lord. And so, Lord, we bring those things to you now. We lay them at your feet. We ask that you forgive us again for these things, Lord, and we ask you to purify us. And we ask that you would take us and that you would help us to stand strong. Lord, we're in this valley and you've been here. You know it. It's tough. It's a struggle. Lord, strengthen us. Give us strength and courage to keep our eyes on you every second of every day. Lord, make the enemy just useless against us. Make his tools useless as you make us useful to further your kingdom, Lord. We want to be your servants. We want to glorify you, not just in your grace. We want to glorify you in what you do through us to other people, Lord. So be with us this week. Protect us, Lord. Guide us. Forgive us. Lord, help us to forgive ourselves, to let these things go. Lord, they're done. You've forgiven us. But help us not to forget how dirty we've been and how clean you've made us, that we would continue to pursue you and follow after you. Lord, protect us this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.